Sharing directing credit with John Landis, Joe Dante and George Miller, Spielberg's next project was The Twilight Zone The Movie, a remake of the sixties series which had been a hit when he was a youngster. The opening scene, the Midnight Special by Creedence Clearwater Revival, kicks off over the Warner Brothers logo, and not the ancient 80s logo. On the DVD I watched, it was the shiny, glistening digital shield. I was being deprived of nostalgia from the start. The opening prologue, directed by Landis, sees two men travelling in a car, one being Dan Aykroyd, the other Albert Brooks. After the tape playing Midnight Special chews up in the car, they embark on a time-killing game of Name the Fiend Tune, eventually ending up on a conversation about the old TV series The Twilight Zone. Corny link, I know, especially as they go on to remember an episode with Rocky and Clash of the Titans legend Burgess Meredith, who will shortly become the movie's narrator. Then Aykroyd poses the question, do you want to see something really scary? Cue Rick Baker's excellent makeup, unfortunately shot with zero fear factor, and the classic theme tune begins. The first segment tells the preposterous story of a bigoted man played by Vic Morrow, angered in a bar and shouting off about Jews and niggers in a scene that is embarrassingly crass. As he leaves the bar, he becomes trapped in some bizarre time warp and arrives back in Nazi Germany as a Jew under persecution. In true Landis form, he has hidden the word "see you next Wednesday" somewhere in the movie, here spoken in German by one of the Nazis. Then again, Morrow leaps through times into the clutches of the KKK, and then he eventually winds up in the jungles of Vietnam. This was to be the scene that stole the show, Landis's elaborate stunt sequence to challenge anything that the mighty Spielberg could do, with copious pyrotechnics and a swooping helicopter, as the racist Morrow tries to save two children. When the filming took place, many believed that Landis was like a man possessed. Despite reservations from many involved that the pyrotechnics could be dangerous so close to the helicopter, Landis dismissed their concerns. In fact, more pyrotechnics were set up. When someone asked if this was going to be okay, he joked, "We may lose the helicopter." Vic Morrow had a premonition that he would die in a helicopter crash years prior to that fateful event on the set of The Twilight Zone. It was actually for a sequence in a TV movie. He was so certain that he wouldn't survive the day that he took out a specific insurance policy ensuring his family should be well looked after in the event of a tragedy during that sequence. The shoot went by without any hitch. His unjustified fear of helicopters became a thing of the past. The scene in The Twilight Zone was to involve Morrow rescuing two native children from the onslaught of the Americans. With one child under each arm, he ran from the waist-high waters of a swamp, the pyrotechnics going off all around him. The helicopter was knocked out of the sky and fell blade first onto Morrow and the two children, obliterating them in an instant. What would follow was a dispute in Hollywood, a court case of manslaughter against the director, which ended nearly a decade later when Landis was acquitted of his responsibility. Something that they weren't tried for was the even more horrendous under-the-table deal that ensured that the children could act in the movie despite it being illegal to film with children after hours. They weren't supposed to be there. The Landis segment is hardly any competition to Spielberg's. It's the worst of the four chapters, shot with the most standard technology, coming across not as a cinematic experience, so much as bad television. One critic back in the day quoted that Landis's segment was hardly worth making, let alone dying for. But that being said, Spielberg's segment wasn't much to shout about either. Spielberg was first to shoot the segment, The Monsters Are Due on Maple Street. He chose to opt out of this segment after the accident, as it also involved nighttime filming with children. Instead, he revised an old episode called Kick the Can, drafting Twilight Zone writer Richard Matheson, who had worked once before as a scribe to Spielberg's Jewel. The tamer and gentler story that Spielberg chose to shoot starred Scatman Crothers as a travelling pensioner who arrives at retirement homes and helps the elderly residents revisit their childhood. It's shot with a more cinematic use of lighting and cinematography, and endearing as it is in a cocoon or batteries not included kind of way, it seems to me very much a cop-out, especially as the director is renowned for chilling excitement. The scene is full of ladles of sentiment and cheesy and cringe-inducing child actors. He could have stolen the show, but he bowed out. If anything, it looks like Spielberg tried to distance himself from the project and the horror of the Vic Morrow tragedy. He was reported to have asked to have his producer title removed from the credits, but the studio had decided not to can the film, refused him, saying it would give out the wrong message and help nail the coffin for all those involved. The third segment, directed by Joe Dante, was the first satisfying scene. We meet a girl in a strange town who knocks a boy over in her car, takes him home to his family. As soon as we meet them, cooped up in their house, watching cartoons, we feel that something is not right. We fear for the strange upbringing of this innocent child. As well as featuring Dante regular Dick Miller, the movie is instantly recognisable as a Dante segment. The wacky, over-the-top, sickly sweet family hustling around young Anthony to the soundtrack of the cartoon feels like gremlins in places. Dante's segment includes the two sequences that always spring to the forefront of my mind when Twilight Zone the movie is brought up in conversation. The shot with the hideous rabbit being pulled out of the hat, and the girl with no mouth. Okay, so the rabbit always seemed more frightening in my memory than the static rubber rabbit in the film, but it always stood out. Mad Max director George Miller is up next. His first real stab at Hollywood after venturing from his home turf of Australia. His segment in The Twilight Zone is a terrific start to a career in Hollywood, stealing the show completely. His segment is full of great techniques and atmosphere. A man with a dreadful fear of flying, haunted by a gremlin out on the wing, eating the plane. The claustrophobia of the airplane is complemented by Miller's use of handheld camera, and unnaturally close and cantered shots of its protagonist. And what better protagonist to fill this role than John Lithgow? Accompanying the gremlin on the plane is Joe Dante's Gremlins theme tune in a precursor by the very same composer, Jerry Goldsmith. Miller continues to direct and lead us directly into the prologue as we follow Lithgow into an ambulance. And there, behind the wheel, listening to Creedence Clearwater Revival, is ambulance driver Dan Aykroyd, a tidy bookend to this untidy shelf of stories. It was strange to watch after all these years, and I guess if it hadn't been for this project, I may never have bothered. But it was surprising to see that two of my favourite directors from my youth, Landis and Spielberg, really didn't shine as bright as they should have here. Well, that's all I've got time for. Thank you ever so much for listening. Don't forget to give us a thumbs up, drop us a comment, and if you haven't already, please check out my videos, check out my channel, and subscribe. Thank you. Good night.